hashtag Safari Live, questions at wild.tv. And please also remember to tell us where you're from. We had an incredible drive. I think two mornings ago, we had some people from Australia, New Zealand. We had someone from Doha. We had various bits and pieces of the world, Romania. And so it's always nice to know where you're from. The bulk of our viewers, of course, in the continental United States, and we'd like to know where you are there as well. Let's go back to the waterbuck, spend at least an hour with him so that, we've got something to talk about. He's a very, very happily eating on what we call a firebreak area. Now, this particular area is not actually required this year round because we had that big drought, which means that there's not much in the way of fuel load. So were a wild fire to come rushing through this area, which it is wont to do between now and the rainy season, well, this would be a good place from which to fight the fire. But you can see that unless Dante's Inferno was to actually come and set this place ablaze, very little fire is going to make it through here because there's simply no fuel for it to burn. And I say the fire season between now and the rainy season, it's because it's dry, we get these hot northwesterly winds like the one that's blowing now, and then come September and the end of September into October, we start to get lightning strikes from the odd storm that brews. They don't normally drop much water to start with, but they do drop lightning onto the ground, and that can set off a bush blaze. But this year we're pretty safe from that sort of thing. And just to keep you posted, we do have something called the Juma Dam Cam, if you wish to look at it. There are some elephants going there now. I'm thinking about making my way there at some stage, but at the moment we can't go there because there are people still in Vuyatela Camp, and, well, they just don't really want us staring at them while they're having their lunch, do they, Brian?
No,
it's a little awkward when that happens, yeah. When you're enjoying your lobster thermidor for lunch and some fellow is staring at you through the lens of a camera. So I think we'll stick with our waterbuck friend. And then from here, we're going to go off towards Biffleshoek Dam and see what we can find that end. Hello, Hayley. How lovely to hear from you. I'm not sure I've spoken to you before, or certainly not very often. You say, what was the animal at the dam cam? Our very astute bunch in final control, consisting of Geraldine the Cheesecake Kent and Rebecca Congo Christensen, have looked it up, and it was, in fact, an African civet. Now, a civet is a common animal here, except it's only very strictly nocturnal, which means we see their tracks all over the roads during the mornings, but we do not see them much when we're driving around. Sometimes we see them at night. I think I've seen two, Brent's seen a few of them, and so we don't see them very often, but if you do watch the dam cam at night, you will often see something like that. He's a rather magnificent fellow, this waterbuck. He's on his own, of course. He's nowhere near any water. Seldom they are in this area, but they will fight over little water territories if they can. He's obviously irritated his harem of ladies, and they've decided that he's not worth being around right now, so they've gone probably to have some girl time on his own, and they've left him to contemplate the error of contradicting one of the ladies in his harem. Silly, silly, silly man, wouldn't you say, Brian? We all know one doesn't do that, not if one wants to spend a Saturday afternoon anything but alone. Okay, we're going to move on now towards Biffleshoek Dam. I'm just going to reattach the microphone to my back. There we go. Hello, Tucker, you're age just 4, and you want to know from Brian what kind of crayons he uses on his thumb. He actually uses very special kinds of crayons, and I'm going to let him tell you what's going on. Brian?
I use a Copic marker. It's like a Copic pen to colour on my thumb with. Yeah.
A Copic marker, but it is xylene free, correct?
Xylene free, alcohol based, so no worries of causing any damage to my thumb.
Right. So, Tucker, very important, if you're going to draw on your thumb with a Koki pen, it must be xylene free. You must tell your mum that. I'm assuming your mum is watching. Xylene free, which means it won't harm your skin. Good question, that. You can see it is a balmy afternoon. I would submit probably around 26 or 27 degrees Celsius, which is pushing up towards the 80 degree mark in Fahrenheit. That's pretty good going for the end of winter, I think. We have about 2 weeks left of winter as far as we're concerned, and then we'll be into the spring. Right, we're going to drop down a gear and go a little bit faster as we head off to the east towards Biffleshoek Dam. While we do that, let us go and find out how Leo Smith is tracking the lions. You like the Leo and the lions there, Brian? Yes, yes.
So what we're doing at the moment is quite an important part of tracking, and it's called guessing. So I'm thinking it's warm, it's hot, I don't see any tracks there. I'm going to check around towards where, if I was a lion, I might go. So I'm trying to think like a lion, I'm putting myself in the lion's head. And if we get no luck in that area, then we will go back to the last tracks and go take a walk and see if we can find them on foot. But I don't know, I've got a feeling they're in this area somewhere. And one thing I've learned after many, many years in the bush is always trust your gut. Quite often, you can't explain why, but you go somewhere and the animal happens to be there. Now we're on top of a crest at the moment, or just off the top of a crest. So we're in sort of what you would call really, really prime mixed broad-leafed woodland. Now, we can find lots of different species in this area. We've already seen an impala, kudu, wildebeest, zebra, elephant, buffalo are all prime candidates. Steenbok, duiker, to be seen in an area like this. Now, as we dip down towards Sydney's waterhole, there's always a chance that the elephants might be taking advantage of this heat of the day to go down for a drink. Hi, Karen, who's the Zimbo in London. Karen is wondering, can I confirm the Styx Pride has 8 cubs? What are their sexes? They do have 8 cubs. There was a while where people thought maybe 2 cubs had been lost, but all 8 have turned up. And I'm not 100% sure on this, but as far as I remember, the Styx sexes are 6 males and 2 females. So a very male-dominated litter for the Styx Pride. Okay. Now, there's always a good chance. Remember, lions don't like to move around too much during the heat of the day, but if something happens to stumble upon them, they might. And the one rule you always know is that if in the bush is to expect the unexpected. So normally they don't walk during the day, but who's to say that today they didn't? Double check this northern boundary. I'm going to pop through to the waterhole, we'll have a quick look there. Now, also, this quite strong breeze we're experiencing this evening is going to keep a lot, as I said, the herbivores a bit more skittish. So it's even harder to find zebra and giraffe and impala. Well, impala is pretty easy to find, they're all over the place, but they're still going to be a little bit nervous. Now, if you're a lion, you want this breeze to continue through into the dark hours. Fortunately for most of the impala and whatnot, it doesn't. It normally settles a little bit later at this time of the year. But this is our windy part of the time of the year. Okay. Let's have a look at the waterhole. I see a shimmering waterhole, but I don't see any large creatures there at the moment. Nope. I was hoping for some elephants. Alas, no luck. Well, let's get back to our lion tracking. And on a positive note, no lion tracks coming out in this area, which means they're definitely still on Juma. Hi Cindy in North Carolina. As we drive through the bush, you'll notice the elephants had pushed down quite a lot of trees, and Cindy's wondering, is any of that wood collected or what is it used for? Very little of it is collected, Cindy, but we do use it for firewood. Other than that, we leave the wood where it is. So if we have a look here, we've got a couple of bits of wood all around us here. Now a fallen log like that is an ecosystem in itself. So the reason we try to minimize the wood we take out of the bush is because that is home now to spiders, scorpions, wood lice, borer beetles, and all sorts of other creatures. So we do try and minimize the amount of wood we collect, and we generally only collect certain species. We leave the rest of the wood out there for all the other creatures. It also creates homes for snakes and for squirrels in certain cases, and dwarf mongoose. So we try to take as little as possible out of this natural environment. Okay. Vim, what do you think? Where are they going? They're here somewhere. I also think they're definitely here somewhere. Let's hope we're not going to be outsmarted by them today. While we keep searching for the largest carnivore in Africa, there's an arboreal primate on the other end of the other camera.
Hello everybody, I'm just getting into the Olympic spirit. I was watching some gymnastics earlier and I thought, well, I would try and do the same sort of thing. This is of course a first for me. I'm also trying to get some delicious smelling gwari flowers, which smell a little bit like lilies. Was that very elegant, Brian? Thank you so much. What? Talking about 6 out of 10. I'll show you 6 out of 10 with my fists. Now, everybody, there are the little flowers, which are pretty nondescript. I'll try and stop them blowing in this howling gale. Got them?
I've got them.
Okay. Now. Oh, these are disappointing. They smell like lilies if you get them at the right age. I think these ones are a bit young. First sort of nice smell of the springtime. I'm going to give them to Brian so that he might try. He too has a very sensitive nose, but those ones are a bit of a disappointment, aren't they, Brian?
Yeah,
yes.
Not as grand as one would hope.
No. Substantially less grand. Anyway, on we go. Now, this was the only road, as far as I'm aware, that was not driven this morning. That is the Gowrie cut line. And, well, it didn't seem to turn up anything other than those gwari bushes and two impala who absconded into the bushes without us. I'm looking in that large jackalberry tree, hoping to see some owls, but there are no owls therein. No. Okay. What we're going to do, apparently there are some elephants at the pan, so we're just going to pop around here and see if they haven't crossed this way. Now, Aaron, you ask a very good question about migrant birds and if there are any that I'm looking forward to seeing. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing most of them, but I'm most looking forward to seeing the first ones. And those should be the yellow-billed kites and the Wahlberg's eagles. And I'm slightly surprised that the Wahlberg's haven't come yet. I think we had them, I'm pretty sure we had them by the 10th of August last year. I said 16th yesterday, but I think it may have even been before that. So I'm looking for that flying cross shape in the sky every day. So Wahlberg's very distinctive by its cross-shaped flying shape. Some impala through there, Brian. Yes. Can you believe it? The other thing you won't believe is that the elephants have left. Ah, here they go. We have an elephant and a little baby elephant. This is wonderful. Hello, elephant. You're the first large species of... Oh, this cow looks very, very skinny, everyone. I'm just going to warn you, this might be slightly disturbing. Just get into a position where you can see her nicely. Ugh, she doesn't look that bad, but she doesn't look great. Just look at her hip sticking out there. That's really not nice. It's the worst one I've seen so far. So although they are eating consistently, they're finding, in theory, things to eat. It doesn't look like they're ever walking around with nothing to eat. I think that the nutrients that they need are unquestionably just not around, and so they're really struggling to find the nutrients they need. Let's move a little bit forward. The rest of the herd is down in the bottom of the pan. We can't go onto the dam wall at this stage because there are still guests in the camp, so we'll just go around this side where they can't see us. And we'll get a long range view. There we are. See how cleverly hidden we are, Brian? They can't see us. Unfortunately, we don't have the super zoom camera. Well, that's all right. We get a full frame of elephants. And they're, I think, probably picking up those bits and pieces of green in the bottom of this dam. Now, I'm still astounded by how, when I got here, of course, this dam was full of water. There were hippo, there were things swimming in it all the time. And we went through most of the summer with it dry. Now that just gives you an idea of the extent to which the drought did affect us. So, yeah, like I've said before, in theory they tell you the warthogs suffer the most from the drought, and I've certainly seen that outside of the reserve, outside one of the reserves on the way to Hoedspruit, really emaciated, dreadful-looking warthogs there. Not here. I haven't seen any skinny warthogs here. The elephants, to me, are the ones that are most obviously suffering from this drought and from the lack of nutrients. And I suspect that they are suffering the consequences of a very poor grass season. Normally in summer they'll eat grass, but they could hardly do that this summer. They were on to winter forage by as early as sort of March. And some of them never got off it. And so that means that the nutrients available in the winter forage of bark and twigs and leaves and pods is that much more denuded. They might also be engaging in a little bit of what we call geophagia, where they're picking up bits and pieces of soil to eat. The soil down here, I suppose, because of the silt that's been brought down in this dam, is probably fairly rich in various nutrients. But we'll see. That was a birchall starling you saw flying off to the right-hand side. And here they've all decided now they're going to go and have a drink. I get the feeling with these elephants, well, with all elephants, that there is a real careful assessment of when and what to do. So I think these little chaps here, you could see they were feeding there, and then the matriarch decided it was safe to go and have a look at the water, and so up they went. But she almost without question gave them an instruction. They didn't just all suddenly start to walk forward like that. There was some kind of communication that went on there. And then, as Jerry says, she's got a view of the dam cam. She said there's another herd that they were possibly talking to. That's also true. I wonder, do we have a shot of them, Jerry, from the front at the dam cam? So I think the zoomie's coming round to focusing on the ones at the water there. And then we'll cut to that view. And they're definitely drinking it from my angle here. I can see them drinking, and that's quite interesting because that water is not the best, but for a long time now there have been no buffalo lying there. There have been no hippo there fouling the water, which means that clearly it's clean enough for them to drink. Oh, Brian, the one in the middle there, that one there on its knees. Can you see it's on its knees there? It's got half a trunk, and that's why it's on its knees. It's having to get right into the water in order to be able to drink. Oh, this is interesting. The zoomie's coming in to have all the elephants in frame, and you'll see the one that I mean with the missing trunk. And drinking twice as fast as the others, and drinking twice as fast because the trunk is obviously half as long, so it holds half the amount. And there you can see that little thing now enjoying its little drink and thinking about possibly having a swim. And it's just like a child playing on building sand. I don't know if you've ever been around a kid in a building site. And he looks like he's going to fall in there. Every time he looks like he's going to fall in, his little tail comes up. Now you see, most of his moisture will be provided by the milk that he's drinking from his mum. So this is more fun for him than it is sort of a necessity. And he just loves playing there in the sand. He enjoys fiddling about in the dust. I don't know if you know what I mean, everybody. When there's a pile of sand, a child will be on it. I was completely unable to stop myself. I'm fairly unable to stop myself even now. When I find a pile of sand, I leap onto it, and I don't know why. But that's exactly what that elephant was doing. Right, now another command has been given. Did you see how they all turned around there? And now you can see they all turned around and faced each other and could well be from... one of them's chasing the other one, I think. I'm not sure that there's actually a real consternation here. You can also see a lot of dust coming out of the middle of the dam. They seem to be a bit spooked by a dust devil there. That's definitely what's happened. A huge cloud of dust blowing over them and making them a little bit nervous. See the little one there thinking about going over the edge there? I'm not sure what they're looking at. The dam cam's a bit shaky to cross to now, but Jerry, can you see what they're looking at, the other side there? This is probably just that other herd of elephants. Yeah, I think there's probably another herd of elephants there, Jerry's seen. Well, as most of you've seen on the dam cam as well. Oh. Hello, Thomas. Thomas, you're wondering about drought, and of course, as you see that dust flying over, it's a good question to ask. You say, what is the longest drought that this area has ever experienced? I don't know, to be honest, but I can say to you, well, I mean, I'm always slightly suspicious when I hear things like that. They said that last summer was the hottest on record. Again, every winter we have, somebody says, well, you know, of course, this is the coldest winter on record, or this is the hottest summer. So I'm not sure if it was, but the drought has been fairly lengthy. I suspect, you know, a drought in this area, if you go for 2 years of rain like we had this year, you'd be pretty much into the most severe drought that we'd ever had. So if we do not have a good rain season this year, we will be into one of the most severe droughts that we've ever had. It doesn't take much to dry this area out simply because of the lack of water that we get. And we're in what we call a semi-arid area. That means an area where you get between 450 and 600 millimeters of rain. I think that's the definition of it. And an arid area would be anywhere less than sort of 400 millimeters of rain. Now that in inches is about 15 inches or so. Anything less than that, you'd be in the Kalahari semi-desert up in the Karoo regions. But out down here, about 600 millimeters, that's 2 feet of rain. Look, Brian, look. Just look at this crested barbet right here. Can you see it? Mm-hmm. Close by. Check this out. That, everyone. Look. Isn't that awesome? The scruffiest bird out here, but unquestionably one of the most colourful, the crested barbet, humble bird, many of them around. Oh, look at that, red and yellow and black and white. I remember, you know, these birds, much like the humble Cape robin when I was in town, when I lived in Johannesburg, I used to put some pawpaw or pepino out every morning when I lived there, and I'd put it outside my bedroom window, and then I'd sit and have my morning coffee, and one of these chaps, or two or three of them, would come and eat the pawpaw, and they'd shout at each other and fight over it, and it was just the most wonderful kind of touch of the wilderness and the wild that a bird like that could live in amongst the mayhem of Johannesburg. The elephants are back drinking now, so whatever it was that alarmed them has ceased to make them scared, and they're now back drinking. And there you can see, I don't know if you can see it there, you probably can, the one on its knees trying to drink with its half trunk. So just keep looking for that one, everyone. I don't think you can see it right now. Probably lost to a snare, I'm afraid. I'm seeing increasing numbers of elephants that have got missing bits of their trunks, and I think they're largely, unfortunately, due to snaring, which I will explain to you. And Karel, you're wondering about the needs of that one with the shortened trunk and whether or not the matriarch is aware of those needs. Yes, I imagine she absolutely is. So in other words, you're saying, would she wait longer? Would they look after it? Would they perhaps give it more time to feed and drink? Yeah, I think absolutely they would. Elephants are known for doing that sort of thing. But it's important to understand, I mean, the snaring thing probably didn't happen in the Kruger itself. There are a number of what we call buffer zones on the side of the Kruger National Park where there are lots of very poor people living, and they do go into the reserves and set snares illegally, but they set snares to catch things like impala so that they can feed their families. And unfortunately, one of the things that sometimes gets caught in those snares would be elephants while they're feeding. And of course, once an animal gets stuck in a snare, they just pull. They're unable to not sort of panic and pull back. And that's so the snares get very tight. And there's no bone in the trunk, of course. So it really doesn't take very long before you know, the blood will be cut off, the circulation will be cut off, and the trunk itself will just fall off. Must be an incredibly painful thing. Now, they're coming towards us. They're still a good 120 meters or so away. That's about 400 feet. And now they're turning away. There's the snared one. Yeah, the snared one is actually still at the waterhole there. Let's just wait here and see if they come past us. I don't know if you noticed the way they walked down the hill there. She walked down with a very kind of, it looks like what we call a must bull swagger. And it's just kind of a warning to animals around them that they're moving now and, you know, just kind of stay out of the way. They open the ears and they move their shoulders from side to side like you saw there. Hello, Hannah. You're 9 years old and you live in South Africa. It's wonderful to hear your voice here from home. You say, how much can an elephant drink in one day? Well, they reckon a big bull elephant can drink about 100 litres of water a day. Now, 100 litres of water, Hannah, if you're 9 years old, you've done probably a little bit of that in your science classes at home, a bit of volume. Well, basically, that's 100 milk bottles in a day. If you can think of a milk bottle or a milk carton, thinking of drinking 100 of those in one day. That's what a big bull elephant will drink, especially in the height of the summertime. Now, these chaps are coming closer to us. We're just going to sit right here and see what happens. Now, they could choose to go around us, but they seem to be choosing to come closer. And you can see now from the dam cam that Jerry's going to cut to where we're sitting in relation to the elephants. Now, I don't know that they're going to make it round to where they're going. I'm not sure that there's a space for them to get up the dam wall, but elephants are much more agile than we think they are. So I'm going to ask you to just keep watching on the dam cam. I don't really want to move just yet. And they, because you can see them going up the hill. If I start the engine, I don't want to give them a fright. What I'll do is just reverse slightly. They stop to feed on the wall now, Jerry says. I'm going to reverse a little. Just don't want to make them afraid, because they've been so confiding with us. So while you watch them, I'll just move so that I can see them again. Rather wonderful that we have this view of them. You've got them there. There we are. We can just see the matriarch there. Amazing. Walking up onto the dam wall. Now, your view of them, I'm sure, was pretty impressive, but you can see how these animals are anything but unagile. And there we've got a view of them. And she's just making sure that everybody comes up after her. And I heard like this, it's obvious to tell that that's the matriarch. She's the biggest cow by some margin. She's obviously older than the rest of them. And it's also obvious that she's leading them. And I think the half-trunk one should be coming up the hill now. Here he comes. Hello, Richard. A very good question from you in Canada. You say, is there a name for an animal that browses and grazes, or is it just called a herbivore? No, it's called a mixed feeder. It's not a particularly imaginative name, Richard, but and probably therefore quite easy to remember. That's how I remember it. It's a mixed feeder. So a herbivorous mixed feeder would be an animal that eats both browse and graze. But of course with elephants they will eat more than that. They'll eat fruit and they will eat bark. Very few other animals will eat bark. They'll eat pods. I wonder if that elephant we saw earlier wasn't a little bit sick, because this matriarch looks to be in pretty good nick in comparison with her. So I wonder if she didn't perhaps have some kind of disease. You can see the hips on this matriarch much less defined, much less obviously prominent. And the little one just staying close to Mum. Maybe thinking about having something to drink, because that trunk ain't quite feeding it yet. Trying bits and pieces. There we go, trunk's starting to function properly now. Mary, you've obviously been thinking about the lions, perhaps. You say do elephants suckle communally in the same way, I'm guessing, as you've seen lions doing. They don't by default, but they will if they have to. So were that little elephant that you're seeing walking down the hill there in a slightly awkward fashion, were that elephant to become orphaned, then yes, some other cow would probably adopt him. I mean, this herd would be a bit difficult, given that there seems to be only one big adult in it. But yes, they will do that. But they won't within a herd if there are a number of lactating females. They won't by default cross-suckle. I imagine it happens, though, you know. I imagine were a hungry calf to go towards a matriarch or a female that had milk or was lactating and wasn't necessarily her mother, I imagine that in some cases she would be tolerant of that and allow the calf to suckle. Let's just wait to see what she does there. I think she's going to make her way down, and then we'll make our way towards Beefles Hook Dam. Hello, George. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? As you see that swelling on her, underneath her hip there, and on the right-hand side. George, you say, how do you tell if an elephant's pregnant? It's normally a swelling, sorry, not behind, just in front of the hip and slightly below it is where you will see the swelling of a potential fetus. So that's basically how you do it, George. I have been mistaken before, though. In fact, I once had an elephant like that, and I was in Zambia around Livingston and with some friends there, and I was the only supposed bush person. I said, well, you can see that cow's pregnant, of course, with which the male elephant went to the loo and revealed immediately through the medium of his fifth leg that he wasn't in fact pregnant at all, but a young bull. On that note, let's go across to Brent and get an update from him.
So we've left the area where we think the lions are. Well, I'm pretty sure there's some lions there. So what looks like happened is the females have left
the cubs
by themselves in one of those little ravines. And I'm not going to go walk in and scare the poor little cubbies. The females have spread out hunting. We've got single tracks going all over the place. So I'm hoping later on the sunset safari, as it gets a bit cooler and they start moving, we're probably going to have a bit more luck. So in the meantime, I'm going to head down towards Cheetah Plains. I feel like I haven't been there in an age. Just to go see what's going on there and look for Inkanin or Quarantine, Cheetah, or maybe even the Styx Pride. And the Styx Pride we're seeing north of there yesterday, so who knows, maybe they've crossed south onto Cheetah Plains. But before I do that, I'm having a sneaky little squiz around some of Karula's favorite areas for leaving cubs. If she's out hunting and she's walked all the way through into Torchwood, I think maybe she left her cubs in one of her favorite spots along here, all in the Moati itself. So I'm just having a few quick squizzes in some of the favorite nursery spots for the Karula's cubs. But we have literally seen a couple of impala and that's it. We have not seen another animal yet. And I think this wind is keeping some of these animals battered down in the middle of these thickets and riverine areas. So I'm going to do a loop into a riverine area to have a quick look, see if there's anything down in the Moati riverbed. while we think about what we are going to, where we're going to explore next, let's see how everyone's doing this morning or this evening, depending where you are in the world, with a quick tree quiz. Not the nearly impossible tree quiz, but a good one to start. Now, this particular individual's been pulled down by elephants a little bit. Let's get a branch. There we go. So I'm going to go back. There we go. The leaves are quite distinct, quite crinkly as well. Quite distinct, quite crinkly. This is a particularly difficult individual of these trees. They do have quite a lot of different forms, depending where they've been fed on by elephants, depending where they're growing. But I think there is another one up ahead, so we'll show you this one again off to my right. What tree is that? If you know the answer, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I will try to show you another example of that tree shortly. But I think it's good. Actually, no, maybe let's leave it at that. Let's leave it a little bit tough, because it's not the hardest tree to identify. Okay, so I'm going to head down now into the Mawati River. See if we find any tracks, or even better, any cats. Okay, so river is a strong word for the Mawati. A better description would probably be a dry creek bed. But it is a favorite for leopards in particular, and all sorts of other creatures. And this little section here, we found Karula's cubs in a couple of times, where she's left them while she's gone hunting. So worth having a quick look. We get to pass under some of these glorious African ebony trees. Give us a little respite from the sun. Hi, Monty in Virginia. Monty's wondering, do these little rivers ever get full of water? They can flash flood, Monty, but they subside very quickly. So it's very uncommon that they flow for more than a day or two. Normally, even if they fly so high we can't cross them, it'll be for a matter of hours before they drop. Okay, so, no such luck yet. No tracks either, but they could be sitting up on the drainage line in the thickets. It's a great place for leopards, great place to store your cubs. Lots of nice trees for them to be able to climb. Good afternoon, Juan Pierre. He says, is this a blueberry tree? It's definitely not, but it shares a name with a common fruit you get outside of Africa, and some of it's actually grown in Africa, but it does share, one of its names does share with a common fruit. Okay, we've checked down to our... Oh, what's that? Oh. I put my binoculars. Ah, no, stump. Okay, so we're on our southern boundary now. Hi, Hannah. Hannah's 9 years old and from South Africa. Is it a round-leaf teak? It's not, Hannah, but I will try find you a round-leaf teak so I can show you why it's not. And in this part of South Africa, round-leaf teaks stay very, very small because they're one of the elephants' favorite foods. The elephants never let them get big. But I'll definitely try spot you a round-leaf teak, Hannah, so I can show you. So the Game Drive Radio is just getting going. Everyone's getting out, listening to the updates. Not really anything to work off yet. And we've got a few more answers. And well done to Diane. It is indeed an apple leaf or a rain tree. And I'll tell you a bit more about it a little later because James has got an animal with a heartbeat.
Now, we have got some kudu here, everybody, and they've been relatively confiding for kudu. I'm going to depress the clutch, hoping to roll forward, but that's not happened, so we're just going to ease forward. Just over the top here, hope there's no squeaking of brakes. Get a nice view of these kudus. A whole lot of cows and a bull, young bull, whose mummy will no doubt be here. Well, there's another bull, also very young. You just get into this position here. They're wondering why on earth we're moving so slowly about them. I'm still attempting to take a photograph of them, but the world's slowest animal photographer is struggling. Yep, not one so far. Just walking under that green tree that you had, there was an apple leaf like the one Brent was talking to you about. These subtle colours at the moment, you'll notice greys and browns and one or two bits of copper and bronze. And if you're lucky, you find an apple leaf tree and you find some green. Let us sneak forward again. This is how you have to sort of gain the trust of animals like kudu. You've got to move around in a way that almost makes you go to sleep because it's so slow. Well, here we go, Brian. I'm going to get this shot of her with the green in the background. Wonderful. Yes, it'll be blurred, but I'm going to get it.
At least try to get the tree shot.
Yes. The tree or the kudu?
The tree.
Not the kudu? No. Oh. All right. I'm going to disagree with you there. But now, of course, the kudu won't look at us. Brian said, everybody, that I need to get the tree in focus, not the kudu. I've disagreed with him. I think I got the kudu. Now she's going to move off, of course. Gosh, it's not easy, you know. She also doesn't want to be on camera. Come on, Mrs. Kudu. Look this way. That's it. She's got an itchy bottom, Brian. I think she sat on a thorn earlier. There we go. Oh, she's going to yawn. Rank average, everyone. Rank average, I have to tell you. I'm not even going to show it to you. Right, I think that's enough of this kudu sighting, don't you, Brian? Yes, let us press on. We still haven't reached Biffleshook Dam, where the great herds of antelope are going to greet us. Possibly vast swathes of buffalo wallowing in the mud, fighting off the elephants. or just some Egyptian geese shouting at each other incessantly. Okay, we're going to turn north now, up Nyala Road North. Sometimes people like to know the names of these roads. And it does get a little bit dodgy for signals sometimes in here. So if there's a bit of breakup, I apologize for that, but we'll be fine once we get out the other side. Last bits of greenery here on our right-hand side, Gymnosporia senegalensis, the red spike thorn trees, a couple of gwari trees, none of them really edible in any meaningful way to the browsers out here. And we're still, remember, not quite sure where that one Nkuhuma lioness has taken her little cubs. Hyena tracks. And, ooh, sorry. What did she say, Brian?
Comms test.
Comms test. Got you, Jerry. Go again. Sorry. Pulled out my wire. Ah, Cheryl. Nice one from you. What animal has the largest population number? You'd probably be quite surprised to know that I think it's most likely Macrotermes natalensis, which of course is the fungus-growing termite that grows those mounds. And in fact, there may be some species of ants that are even more numerous than that, but I'm going to go with Macrotermes natalensis. That is an animal, of course, but I mean, normally when we refer to animals, we often mean mammal, don't we? So the most numerous mammal in this area, other than the human being, would be an impala. They're by far the most numerous mammals that we have on the reserve. I'm just making sure these are hyenas and not wild dogs. No, they are hyena tracks. Not very distinct, so I'm not going to try and stop and show them to you. And then, of course, if we are we're looking at sort of higher animals, if you like, so the vertebrates, I guess the most numerous vertebrate in this area, when they come through here, would be the red-billed quillas, which are probably the most numerous bird in the whole world. And so when they come flocking through here, they will come through sometimes in millions, and that makes them immediately the most numerous vertebrate in the area. A vertebrate being something with an endoskeleton or an internal skeleton like us, unlike a termite. I'm astounded we still have signal. That's great news indeed. Not even any breakup at all. Connor is going to pat himself soundly on the back for this effort. There's a Nyala. Two of them. Three. 5, 6. Now, everybody, this is the very first time I've ever managed to have a sighting here. It's always been black screen here before. Beautiful Nyala. And of course, so it was quite a good place to have a rest if you wanted to have a rest on drive. So we're not going to be able to do that anymore, are we, Brian? No. Take another rank average photograph. Yes, as Jerry says, very funny, Jerry. Ha ha ha. Nyala Road with Nyalas, indeed. Well done, Jerry. Bit of signal break up there. He's a magnificent bull, that chap, isn't he? I wish he'd look here so that I can take his portrait. But he won't. Now he's put his head down behind a tree. Very irksome of him. so slow and sedate, these fellows. They never seem to be in too much of a rush. Well, unless they're being chased by wild dogs. Then they look quite rushed, don't they, Brian?
Exceptionally.
Yes. The light is just starting to soften, everyone. You can see that it was pretty harsh to start with. And now as we head towards the latter parts of the afternoon, it's just starting to soften a bit, which makes that backlit impala look rather pretty. Of course, none of them will look at the camera. These photographs, I'm almost certain, will be destroyed as soon as I put them on my machine. And look at the grass just behind them. If we look up at the termite mound just behind there, you can see that lovely grass just glowing there. That's that, I think it's that Chlorus, that feathered Chlorus, Chlorus roxburghiana. Indeed, it would seem to be that. Growing on the termite mound there. This is a very peaceful little scene, everybody, especially with the gentle northwest wind blowing. And not a bird in earshot. Not one. This is very strange. There's the bull. Now, the ewe, of course, is looking after the... Well, he doesn't look after them. He dominates this harem, so most of these will be his offspring. But that's not a fixed kind of arrangement, so he will move off to other bulls at various times. It's quite possible that one of these cows is an estrus, and that's why he's with them. But it's not a sort of stable arrangement like a zebra herd, where... The stallion is, he's always with the same herd. You get a sense of the peace of this area now. A complete lack of sound. Right, I think we shall move on now, Brian, don't you? Shall we go and see what is at the dam? Right, on we go. It is so peaceful. That is why I'm speaking in such a peaceful voice, Brian. Thank you so much. Yes. Hello, Monique in London, you say. That you are always fascinated by the fluffy tails of the Nyala, but they seem so almost incongruous. They are. The other ones that do, but most of the tragolaphid species, the spiral-horned antelope, have got fluffy tails. The kudu also have got quite fluffy tails, and the bushbuck likewise. I'm not sure why. I mean, well, they're fluffy and white underneath because they flick them up when they're running, and that helps them to follow each other through the thick bush. So perhaps that's why they're fluffy. But they are definitely fluffier than the impalas, for example. All right, Brent Smith has managed to make it all the way across to Cheetah Plains, and Rusty, let's go and find out what his discoveries are.
So we've had some discoveries. Unfortunately, the Styx Pride on a kill not too far from us, but unfortunately to the north of us. I'm not sure, it sounds like a buffalo. I'm not sure how big the buffalo is. But there's always still a chance of Mr. Q, one of our favorite leopards. Of course, Cheetah, or Nkanyin and her two cubs. And I'm hoping, what I really feel like on this sunset safari is a nice big elephant bull that's come in from the Kruger, a nice big tusker. So I'm gonna check all the water holes first. We're we're about to approach 3 in a row pan. I'm really hoping there's a big elephant there. Hi Chitra! And Chitra's in India. And she says, with the onset of spring, is there going to be an increase in the bird population? Most definitely, Chitra. We're going to get our migrants back, but I think the migrants might be a little bit late this year because of the drought. And even with those summer migrants, it all depends on local rainfall, what area they come to. So it's never a sure thing, so to say. But there will definitely be a lot more birds. We should start seeing, the first will be probably the European swallows. Maybe some carmine beaters, a little bit later the European beaters, the woodlands kingfishers. So fingers crossed there'll be lots and lots and lots of birds. But there are definitely not lots and lots of elephants at the waterhole. It doesn't look like there have been, no, haven't been here today either. The baby there. Look at that. A baby blacksmith lapwing. He's gonna hide there. I can hear the adults tinking away. That's the baby. Isn't that incredible? Now the adults are flying around making a lot of noise trying to distract us from where the baby is. That baby immediately scuttled into a protected area and nestled down. And you can see the camouflage of those little creatures is incredible. And it's not going to be able to fly yet. I'm not going to stay too long because mom and dad get quite upset. But isn't that fun, that little baby blacksmith lapwing? So mom and dad are just over there. I said, we're not going to stay too long. They get quite upset. So what, there we go, look at that. Yes, we're not gonna stress them out too much, we're gonna move on. Now, most of the lapwings have an incredible defense for their youngsters because their youngsters aren't able to fly for a while and they nest on the ground. So if we were on foot walking there, that the lapwing will actually run and pretend to have a broken wing in front of you to try to lure you away from where the baby is. Very, very dry. No elephants here. Doesn't look like they've been here today either. Maybe they're all at the Cheetah Plains pan. So that was 3 in a row pan we've just passed. I bet you heard a buffalo through here last night by the looks of things. Maybe that's the same herd that the Sticks managed to catch that buffalo out of. See, the Cheetah Plains area is slightly more arid than Juma. Even though we're not too far away, they've had less rain, so there's less grass, less leaves, and that's why the water holes in this area are so important for the animals and always a good place to check for animals. We're going to keep moving towards the next waterhole. While we do that, James has got the tallest creature in the African bush.
The tallest creature next to, of course, Brian Joubert. Not so, Brian. Exactly. There's a giraffe, everybody, as identified by the fact that it is browsing. That's how you know it's a giraffe, don't you, Brian?
Yes.
The identifying feature, the fact that it's eating leaves and is relatively large. It is a bull giraffe. We know that from the balding horns. I too have balding horns. Brian, you do not have balding horns, do you?
I have lovely flowing luscious locks.
You are very lucky to have lovely flowing luscious locks. Them days is over in my case. This giraffe is now offended, of course, that we have described him as having balding horns. I was also offended, Mr. Giraffe, until I got used to the idea. He looks deeply surprised. I don't know why I find that amusing. He's quite amusing. Let me just go back a little bit more. And a bit more. It's almost like he's looking at me as if to say, yeah, who do you think you are? How dare you comment about my lack of hair? Well, my friend, that is the way of things. And you must get used to it. Because I have to say, Mr. Giraffe, once you accept and embrace your baldness, you will feel so much better about it, I promise. I speak the truth to you. There, you see, he's now starting to agree with me, Brian. You see that, how he's moved his ears. He's coming to a state of acceptance now.
I think you just shocked him.
I think I did, to start with. But I think now that he's over the shock of the realization that he's losing his hair, he's going to be okay. We could call him the Jason Statham of giraffes. But then we'd be going too far with the joke, wouldn't we? It would be rather ridiculous. Yes. He also has beautiful eyelashes, though, doesn't he, Brian? Yes. Very impressive eyelashes, my friend. He just looks so utterly astounded by our presence here. Come on. There we are. And again, just all around him, if Brian zooms out a little bit, you'll see the light shining through these tamburti trees. Now, the tamburti trees, not quite evergreen, but probably semi-deciduous, which means they lose their leaves periodically, and then they come back again. And with the giraffe, one of the few animals that's able to eat the poisonous sap of the tamburti. Not many can do that. A very fine fellow indeed. We've yet to make it to Biffleswick Dam, everybody. We keep being stopped by these animals. Our species list today, of course, Brian, vast. Impala, nyala, kudu, giraffe, waterbuck, elephant.
Our cup doth overflow.
Our cup doth overflow. And crested bobbit. There he is. The classic giraffe tilt. Very nice, Brian.
Thank you.
Yes.
I do what I can.
You do. Very well. Let me go back slightly more, everybody. Oh, beautifully framed. Yes, no, that look is definitely one of disdain on his face, everyone. He's not even chewing the cud. He might be, he's looking behind us at something. I think it's just the swaying of the trees in this gentle breeze. And again, you cannot hear any kind of bird for some reason. And I just don't understand. I don't get why there aren't any birds calling this afternoon. There weren't any yesterday afternoon either, you know. Now he's heard something. Oh, very good idea. Patricia, you say maybe I can tell him what tree helps with baldness. Well, I can tell him for free that no tree helps with baldness, but I can tell him that apparently Mr. Giraffe, the, oh, I'll call you Jason from now on, apparently the Papia capensis or jacket plum tree does in fact help with baldness. So what you can do is you can take it, rub it on the top of your horns and see if the luscious locks of your youth don't return. I personally think you should just embrace it. Yes, he's very shocked. Okay, let's move on to Biffleshook Dam. We're not far from there. Good luck. That is the most bemused giraffe I've ever seen. Hello, Arba. You want to know if a giraffe has ever behaved in an aggressive fashion towards me? No. I have never seen a giraffe behave in an aggressive fashion towards a human being, and I have been within 1 meter at one stage. I lay on the ground and let one come and say hello to me, and it came to within a meter and was looking at us. So, no, I have never seen that. They will become aggressive if they are sufficiently threatened. So, with lions and with leopards, they will absolutely become quite nasty. They kick exceptionally well with both feet, front and back, and lions can often be killed when trying to hunt giraffe. If the giraffe aims a well-placed kick at a lion's head, the lion will often be killed. So that does happen if you threaten them sufficiently, but I've seldom, I've never threatened a giraffe to that point. That said, I do know of people who've been hurt by a giraffe inadvertently, especially at night. So they watch them being hunted by lions, and then the giraffe, of course, if you're shining a spotlight, becomes totally panicked. It'll run, it can run at the car and won't see the car, and it'll just run straight over it. Now, that's a 1.5-ton animal in the case of a big giraffe. And so you can imagine 1.5 tons hitting a car like this. And because it's so gangly and long, it basically just folds over whatever it runs into. And so you can get yourself and your guests into quite a lot of trouble. So you do hear the odd story like that, but that's about the sort of level of damage and how damage is done by a giraffe if it happens. Right, we're arriving at the Great Waterhole. Hello, Brock. You want to know about the different kinds of giraffes that you find around Africa and how many kinds there are? Well, it's a bit of a moot point. Lots of people debating how many kinds of different giraffes we get, but I'll show you a picture of all of them. I think the general consensus at the moment is about 9. But it varies between 7 and 13. Now, while you are looking at Biffleshook Dam, I shall retrieve pictures of all these different kinds of giraffes, all of which are the same species, according to some. Some say they're different species. Gosh, I just find it rather confusing. The one that we get here, everybody, is called the southern giraffe. Let me just find them all for you. This book I've got is wonderful because it's got all the different pictures of the different kinds that we get. Luckily, nothing has fallen prey to the mud yet. Right, can you see that, Brian? Is that fine? Okay, so we get the reticulated giraffe. Ooh, they're all in Latin. It's going to be difficult to understand. That's the one we get. That's the southern giraffe. Then you get the reticulated giraffe, the Angolan giraffe, which should be Angolensis. It is Angolensis. I don't see Angolensis suddenly. Which isn't... there it is. That's the one down at the bottom of the page there. Angolensis. Then the one up near sort of Tanzania and Kenya, which is the blue one, which is called Tipakushki. Basically, that's that one there. You can see that. I think that's also called the Maasai giraffe. And then you get the reticulated giraffe. That's also up in sort of East Africa. Yeah, and a light morph reticulated giraffe. So lots of different kinds. They've got, I think they've got seven here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They've got 8 in this particular example. Right. So those are the different kinds of giraffes. But like I say, some people say they're species, some people say they're subspecies, some people say that there are 13 of them. I don't think they really care. I think the point is that they can probably all interbreed. Maybe the West African ones will struggle to interbreed with the Southern and East African ones, but I think you'll find that they could probably hybridize very successfully, and there'd be no sort of lack of species integrity, if you like, through that. I think it's just a fact that they're different colors, different races from the different geographical positions in which they find themselves. Really not much going on here. Hello, Gracie. Thank you very much. You say old is beautiful. And in, what is it? Old is beautiful, and in boys it's cute. Is that correct, Gracie? Oh, and the bald is beautiful. Thank you very much, Gracie. I think you're absolutely bang on correct. Well done. Now, let's go back across to Brent Leo Smith and find out how he's going in the great plains of Cheetah.
Our tracking endeavors are not working in our favor today. We've just been tracking a male leopard. Quite nice tracks considering the time of the day and the amount of wind, but he has decided to go on holiday to the Kruger National Park. There's a nice clear track up ahead, so we'll show you that one. Now, it could be quarantine, it could be Shivambalan. Those are the two male leopards that are seen most frequently in this area. It could be an unknown male from Kruger. There we go. You can see the tracks there in the road. Big male leopard track. Alas, he's gone on holiday. Well, even the leopards deserve a holiday. And that particular section of Kruger that's behind us here to the east is what we'd call a wilderness area. So there's only a few management roads, but there are no public tourist roads or anything in that area. So it is an area where the animals can go, but they won't see any people, maybe the odd anti-poaching patrol. Now, updates on those two cheetah, they also went on holiday to Kruger. Okay, now I am looking for two trees in particular. I'm looking for a different version of the wren tree to show you, and I'm looking for a round leaf teak tree, and hopefully I'll find those shortly. This is not the right place to look for them on the open plains, but we're going to scoot through the open plains and then head back down towards the west, and maybe we'll get lucky. Tundi, the female leopard, sometimes in the area, sometimes her unnamed daughter is also in that area. But that's the only tracks we've seen on Cheetah Plains so far, that male leopard on his way out to go on a holiday in the Kruger. Now, we went past Cheetah Plains Power, and I was really hoping for some ALEs, but alas, no elephants, so maybe we'll find them somewhere else. Okay, now we're right in this area between the two different open areas. So we've got nice big marulas around. We've got this broad-leafed woodland, mostly made up of red bush willows and variable bush willows. Oh, there we go. There's a... And because it's quite windy, it might work quite well today. So here we go, the seeds of the red bush willow. Now, let's see if we can get the wind to line up with us. The wind is coming from the north. There we go. Now, I'm going to fix it shortly. Incredible design. Of course, now the wind decides to die down. But you can see it's got four wings. Now, those wings are designed to catch wind. There we go, like that. Now, that one did it perfectly, so I'm going to put it there to catch the wind again. I'll put the bit further there. Yeah. Okay, come on, wind. Give us a gust. Gust wind. Oh, you want to go? Let's just change the angle. Get the wings to catch the most wind possible. There we go. So that's how they spread. They're blown by the wind at this time of the year. That's why it's releasing seeds now at this time of the year when it's quite windy. And the wind will blow it and they'll roll. And that's how they spread and disperse their seed throughout the area. The other thing that disperses seed for them is actually the brown-headed parrot. Is a great seed disperser of Cambrotum. Sorry, I just saw a track that I didn't notice. Oh, hello. This is a very nice track. Considering the wind. It's a female leopard. Now this is in Kanyeni's territory. And I haven't heard any of her tracks called in. It looks like she might have come straight out of the Kruger. And in here. Now I'm just going to have a quick look a little bit to each side because she does have those young cubs. Young adults are on 9 months old now. So their footprint size will be very similar size to her. And it's just one track. Now look at that, the bush willow has got us a lead because I probably would have missed those while I was driving if it hadn't been for that bush willow. Very interesting. Well, we've got a lead, we've got something to follow, so let's get on it. What we're going to do is we're going to make sure we can zoop around the block and see if the tracks come out on the other side. Also, do you want to make sure she isn't hunting through this area. Now a lot of female leopards really like areas like this. They've often got quite a lot of steenbok, which is a very small antelope, as well as duiker. So we're gonna go on a big loop around here, and if we don't get any luck, then I'll go back to that last track and I'll take a walk through these thickets. Catcher's wondering, how do we recognize the different tree species? Is it their leaf shapes? Does they all look so similar to me? Well, it's not only their leaf shape, Catcher, it's their general shape. So, and bark and where they grow are all really good indicators. And of course the leaves as well. Always checking on the termite mounds. We all know leopards love a termite mound. But so far, no tracks coming out. Now this is the next big area for us to check very carefully. Make sure they don't pop across here. Hi, Megan in Texas. Megan says she's a safari addict, but this is her first time asking questions. Well, welcome to the question fray, Megan. Megan would like to know if we've got any updates on Sindile. Megan, at the moment, I haven't heard about Sindile for a while. Sorry, it's just a funny track, just the angle on hard ground, and it's a small hyena. But Megan, the last I heard, he was in the Manuleti, so I'm not 100% sure. I haven't heard any updates from him for quite a while. Okay, come on, little leopard, where are you hiding? So in this part of Africa, leopards will generally, you'll only really see them crossing big open areas like this. They don't tend to hunt too often on them. Not enough cover for them. But animal behavior throughout Africa is completely different. So a leopard in the Serengeti or Masai Mara has to hunt in the grassy areas because that's where the prey species are. What did you see? Vem has spotted our good mate Gnorman. The Gnormless Gnu. The victor. The wildebeest champion of the southern plains of Cheetah Plains. And of course, on the other plains, a little bit further to the north, is where Normal Norman, his nemesis, lives. And he's got an ox pecker. Sorry, Vim, just go a little bit to the right. Did I see an impala there? It was just a bush. I was just trying to check to know if to listen for alarm calls. Oh, on the ground, he's taken off. A lilac-breasted roller. Nice camera work, Vim. Dup. Just gonna keep going along here, making sure her tracks don't come up. The one reason that might draw her out into the open is this little bit of water that's been left from that rain we had about 10 days ago. What's that in the distance? Straight ahead of us, then, on the road. I think it's impala. Nice herd of impala there. So I know we've got some watchdogs on the corner. And we'll alarm at any cat that's near them. While we keep looking for this leopard, let's go see how James is faring back on Juma.
Sorry about that, everybody. I was overwhelmed with shyness suddenly as we came live and I had to prepare myself. Then I hit that tree. It was very scary, wasn't it, Brian? Terrifying. Right, now, we are on the far northeastern corner of Juma. We are going south down the Cheetah Cut line and there are some waterbuck. We've seen the male and now, Brian, the female and the babies. So amazing, is it not? They too are slightly astounded by us. And one a little male and one a little female there. You can see they've both got little horns. No, only the one. Beautiful. How furry they are. I've always thought it must be good to be a water buck in the winter. It must be a bit warmer. You just move a little bit closer. There we go. Now, there's an ideal opportunity here to observe the white marking on the buttocks, which is supposed to be some kind of a following mechanism. I'm not convinced that that's what it is. Of course, many other antelope, of course, follow each other very successfully without having white markings on their bottoms. I'm not sure why it would be like that. Isn't that nice? I think that's beautiful. Look at the grey colour there. They're moving through the bush. Perfectly, perfectly camouflaged for the winter. Not so much for the summer, but then they hide. If we were looking at this in summer, everyone, you wouldn't see those animals. They'd be hidden by leaves and thick bush. So in the winter, a perfect colour for camouflage. And we're often asked, what should we wear on safari? What should we bring on safari? And of course, I mean, if you can get a colour as close to a waterbuck's coloration as possible, that's probably the most easy way you will stay camouflaged. Not really that you need to be camouflaged if you're on safari, but if you do want to be camouflaged, that's a good colour to be. Not so, Brian. Yes. Ah, Brent has managed to find not quite the leopard for which he is still searching, but something much larger.
So, we've just been checking around the area to make sure those leopard tracks didn't come out. We've come across a very small little group of elephants. There's one young bull, this big female, and her calf that are coming towards us. And they're just heading back towards the Kruger, actually back towards where those leopard tracks were. So if we hear them trumpeting just now, we'll know that they might have spotted that leopard. Hello, naughty boy. What do you want, mister? Lovely little young boy. Hello. What do you want, Tara? Are you going to misbehave yourself? Hey. I'm watching you. Why are you sniffing my tire? I'll sniff you too. Yes, you're very scary. Just coming to give us a little sniff. He was actually sniffing the tire. Moving on. Can't hear any or see any others. I'm Monique in London. Monique's wondering, why are elephants' digestive systems so ineffectual? Surely they should have evolved to be able to take more nutrients. Well, Monique, they are one of the keystone species. So if their digestive process was more effective, they wouldn't push around and break up as much as bush. They wouldn't defecate as much, and their defecation is home to fungus species. The Franklin and squirrels dig around in it, and by them pushing and pulling over trees, they create homes for whole other animals. So you probably find it's due to the fact that if they were more effective, they would have less effect on the ecosystem, and their effect on the ecosystem is a very important part of the ecosystem. So it's one of those really strange, incredible little miracles of nature, that everything is in balance.